Hello, and welcome to Smart Women Read Romance, a book review podcast where we fangirl over all things romance. I'm Juliette.
And I'm Jessen.
Today we'll be reviewing Darkfever by Karen Marie Moning, the first book in her Fever series. But before we dive in, make sure you subscribe to the podcast on your preferred podcast platform, and please rate and review us. Jessen and I would love to hear from you, so follow us on our social media pages at SWReadRom. Join our Patreon for access to exclusive giveaways, a look behind the scenes of our episodes, and exclusive content, including monthly videos where we answer all of your burning questions. We'd like to give a few shout-outs to our amazing patrons, Melina, Lexi, Danielle, Ashley, Stephanie, Justine, and Rachel. You girls rock. We love you.
Woohoo! We love you.
Okay, so what are we going to discuss this week? Let's do some chit-chatting.
Okay, so I have a couple things that I just kind of want to chit-chat about. I'm so freaking pumped. Game of Thrones did a little teaser, like an actual teaser with the air date. The air date is going to be April 14th. And the teaser was so amazing.
And the family tomb.
In Winterfell's crypts.
Oh, God.
It's so amazing because the teaser is so focused on Jon.
Yes.
And Jon's parentage and him finding out and what's that going to mean.
Yes.
And I've watched it. It's only, what, 90 seconds? But I just got so hyped about it, and it's amazing. And actually, I love to listen. I got you into the Binge Mode podcast, they go over every single episode in Game of Thrones.
And now I've gotten Kevin into it. Like, he's
It's so addicting. I love Jason and Mal. I want to be their friends. Like, I would be their besties.
They're freaking hilarious.
They have my heart. But they did a breakdown, a video breakdown of the trailer. They're just like us. It's on their Facebook. Go check out the Binge Mode Facebook. You can see them.
Tonight,
see Mal later. Get so hyped up.
Is she wigging out, nerding out?
She's wigging out. It's amazing. I love Mal so much. But
we can't relate at all to
We don't do any of that shit. We don't get excited and overenthusiastic.
We're freaking weirdos.
Yeah.
Nerds.
So I think we'll be doing a minisode on Game of Thrones. Possibly two.
Hell yeah.
I think what our plan is before Game of Thrones.
We're going to do sort of a recap of everything up until, right?
Right. And our predictions for the final season.
Right, right.
So that'll be a minisode before April 14th. So the week before, probably.
This minisode will be 5 hours long. No, I'm kidding.
I'm going to get our thoughts together.
You're going to have to edit the fuck out of this one.
Oh, gosh. I'm going to keep us on track. There's a lot of things to discuss, but I will keep us on track.
Right.
So we'll do our predictions, and then I think another minisode after Game of Thrones officially ends to just discuss how we feel.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's
awesome.
That's what we love to do on our minisodes, talk about other things besides romance books. We're going to talk about
nerding out about.
Yes, we're going to talk about romance in Game of Thrones.
Oh,
so.
God.
I'm excited about that.
Oh my God.
So excited.
Yeah.
You can find out updates on our Patreon too. We also talk about that in our video chit chats. If you have not gone seen our first video chit chat, it is open to the public. You do not have to be a patron to watch it. So go head over there and we geek out over all things, including Game of Thrones, also Marvel.
Oh yeah, we talked about Marvel.
You had a cool story.
Yeah, I talked about this a little bit in the video on our Patreon, that Comic-Con is in New Orleans every January, the Wizard World Comic-Con. And my husband goes every year, and he always goes and gets, you know, pictures taken with celebrities, whatever. Well, this year is the first year that my oldest son, who is overseas in the Navy, was not with him. So he brought his picture because they paid for a picture with John Bernthal, the Punisher, Frank Castle, right?
Yeah, he's cool.
And when they do these pictures, the photo ops, it's like so quick. It's like you walk up, hey, picture, leave. And so he was getting his comic book, his Punisher comic book, autographed. And so Kevin was.
Mm-hmm.
So when he got up there, he's like, you know, I better just ask him and make sure it's cool. Like, because he wanted him to hold the picture of Justin in his Navy uniform. So he gets up there and he's like, hey, you know, man, look, I just wanted to ask you, you know, if this would be okay. And John Bernthal, he stepped from behind the autograph table. He's like, dude, he's like, I would be honored to do that. He's like,
what a nice guy.
He was so nice. So he signed one of the Punisher to Justin. Your dad misses you. You know,
I
stay
love
strong.
It. Did y'all send it
Give
to
him? Hell. No, John,
are y'all waiting?
No, John told Kevin that he gives that to him when he gets home.
So
we're saving it for
love
when he
it.
Gets home.
A little surprise. So he doesn't know at all?
No, he does know.
A picture?
Know.
Okay.
Yeah. Justin got a little he was a little, he said, I got a little teary-eyed. Oh. Thanks, Dad. You know?
I'm so excited about Punisher season two. Yes. It looks so badass. I watched the trailer, and whenever I heard that Alice in Chains song, Wood, over Girl. There, oh my God, it
we
got me so
We spent an entire
pumped.
Morning discussing this on the way to work, remember?
Yeah.
Back
yeah.
and forth. Like, we could not even.
It's amazing. And Josh Stewart, I don't know if you know him from anything, but I know him mostly from Criminal Minds. He was Jennifer Durow's love interest. And actually, he was from Louisiana. His character was from Louisiana.
Is
and
it
I
early
love
Criminal Minds? Because I watched it in the beginning,
yes.
but we stopped watching it
yes.
after a while.
They went to New Orleans for a case. And it's just so funny because people try to do a Cajun accent. He did.
Oh, Lord.
He didn't try to do like a Cajun accent.
Yeah.
It's more like Southern.
Yeah.
But.
And they don't have Cajun accents in New Orleans,
no.
by the way.
Hey,
they
that's
sound more
gonna
like
be,
New Yorkers.
That is going to be another minisode. Actually, that's going to be minisode 5, I think.
What,
where
which?
We talk about Louisiana
oh,
stuff.
Louisiana stuff.
Cajun
Gras,
things.
All the
misconceptions,
intricacies. Yes,
all that.
Myths. No,
yeah.
we don't have alligators in our backyard. Most of us.
So, anyway... You know what I thought was really cool? Because Josh Stewart's character in that trailer, he plays this priest
yeah.
in The Punisher. I read an interview and he was talking about his character saying that he has a lot of internalized anger, but he hides it behind
Ooh.
His like religious, like, he's like a religious fanatic almost.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like crazy. And it kind of reminded me in Darkfever, since this is the subject of our podcast tonight,
right.
it reminded me of Rocky O'Banion and how he just like hangs up all of that religious
the
art.
Relics.
And he's just like basically Michael Corleone
yeah.
from
yeah.
The Godfather.
Yeah.
He just.
And, 'cause I want, ooh, that's a good. Okay, we're going to come back to that conversation.
Just
Please bring that
was,
back up because
I
don't
will.
Want to say it now. I want to wait till the spoilery
Definitely.
Part.
It's in our notes, so
yes.
I will definitely be bringing that up.
Okay.
But yeah, so I guess we should start actually getting into Darkfever now.
Right, yeah. So you guys, obviously, this is Darkfever by Karen Marie Moning. It's a single POV told by our heroine, Mac, but in a very interesting way. Not only do we get Mac's point of view in the present as the story unfolds, but Mac from a year into the future occasionally interjects with her commentary in a way that heightens the mystery of the current story. It's very interesting. You know, it's like, if I'd only known then what I know now sort
yes.
of thing. And it does make you go, ooh, what does she know now? You know?
Yeah.
So it's a really unique storytelling method that I didn't really fully appreciate until revisiting this book after reading Shadow Fever.
Yeah, the fifth book.
Yeah. KMM combines mystery, magic, and the fae of Celtic lore with an eerily beautiful and dangerous Dublin as its background. One thing is missing. The steam level of this romance is pretty non-existent. There is no sex and barely a kiss to be seen.
Yeah. So some listeners may be wondering, is this even a romance novel? You just said there's no sex and barely a kiss.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, this book is a part of a romance series, but the relationship is on the slowest of slow burners.
Yeah.
Slowest of slow burners. Like, mm-hmm. trust us, it's worth it.
Yeah.
I promise. Or should I say Jericho Barrons is worth the wait?
Yeah. She even beats up Miranda Zapata in the slow burning category.
Oh, gosh. But. It's amazing, though. The mystery, I think, is what really sells it.
Oh, yeah. So what's the appeal of this series to a couple of self-proclaimed sex scene loving romance enthusiasts like us? These characters, guys. Man, these characters are so compelling. The transformation of Mac, our heroine, in the first book alone is something to witness. And Jericho Barrons remains an enigma that you can't help but want to know more about. There is a rhyme and reason to Karen Marie Moning's Darkfever mad genius.
Yes, it's insane going back and reading mm-hmm. this again. So this launching point in the Fever series introduces Dublin as ground zero of a fae apocalypse
mm-hmm.
and revolves around a small town girl who just wants answers to the mysterious circumstances of her sister's death.
Right.
And it'll catapult you into this world where hope strengthens and fear kills.
Yes.
That is a tagline of this whole series.
It's awesome.
And I really love that line
Me
so
too.
Much.
Love it.
And the dark and broody tone is really balanced by the rainbow-hued personality of Michaela Lane. I love her rainbow
that
girl
was
personality.
Genius by Karen Marie Moning.
I love
that was
it.
Really genius to bring
yeah.
the lightness in with that.
Yes. So let's talk a little bit about our MCs.
Yeah. Let's talk about the characters. So Michaela Lane, or Mac, as she prefers to be called, is a small town girl who hasn't experienced much of the world beyond the safety net of Ashford, Georgia. And she likes it that way. There are few things that she enjoys more than catching rays by the pool, her mom's home cooking, and having the latest shade of pink nail polish. But her world is rocked when she gets a call from Dublin saying that her sister, Alina, has been found murdered. When no answers are forthcoming, Mac travels to Dublin to discover the truth. What she doesn't expect is to find out more about herself than anything else. She's a she-seer. That's Gaelic. S-I-D-H-E.
Yeah. Hopefully we pronounce it right.
Yes. A person who can see the Fae, powerful magical beings with no sense of right or wrong, and they might be responsible for her sister's death. Then, of course, there is Jericho Barrons.
Woohoo! Oh, my God.
Jericho Barrons, the enigmatic owner of Barrons Books and Baubles. I love the alliteration.
Me too.
And the one man who seems to have the answers to Mac's questions about this crazy world of magic, fairies, and a dark book that everyone seems to be after. How far can she really trust a man who demands her help in hunting down fae objects in exchange for protection? So, Jess,
yes.
This is a longtime favorite series of ours.
It is.
It's a uniting series of ours.
Yes.
Any new discoveries going back to the beginning after all that has happened with the Fever series for you?
Oh, yeah. I noticed right away how well thought out and planned the first five books in the series were.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
It's especially when juxtaposed to the attempt of a Danny O'Malley series, which comes mm-hmm. after the first five books. But let's not get into that travesty.
We're not going to talk about that.
Don't
go there.
But I can see every little breadcrumb that mm-hmm. KMM plants in Darkfever. Mm-hmm. Some that aren't even revealed in its entirety until Shadowfever, the fifth
yeah.
book.
I agree.
It's truly amazing writing. I can't get over it. And after reviewing Spell of the Highlander for the podcast and getting to know so much about Kian's background mm-hmm. from the very beginning of the book, and then getting Jericho Barrons, a complete mystery. It was
right.
such just like a mind fuck for me because it's amazing how she switched gears mm-hmm. and it felt so right. Like it
yeah.
felt,
yeah.
I wasn't mad mm-hmm. that our main hero, we basically know nothing about him at the
right.
end of this book.
Right. We still don't know who, what, where he is.
No,
like, what
no.
is going on.
And I'm really surprised at the restraint that KMM shows and her conviction in hardly revealing anything about him in the first book. I mean, that's some definite balls.
I would love to have seen her outline for
yes,
this series.
Me too. It's probably detailed as fuck because
yeah, it has to be.
There's so much she isn't telling us about him in this book, and it's crazy. But all the hints are there.
Right.
Reading it, I'm like, I know that is
I know.
A hint.
It's well, and it's
crazy.
So funny because when I was rereading it, I was like, wait a second. We don't even find this out yet? When do we find that out? Like, all that's in later books. And I was
right.
like, but it's so compelling.
It
storytelling is so compelling. It's
it
like,
is.
This is really just a little introduction into the world.
Oh,
honestly.
Yeah. Definitely. Just, yeah. you know, the surface ripples are there.
Yes.
We didn't even dive deep into this.
Yes. So if you have not read this, we are moving into the spoiler section now. If you like paranormal, you need to go grab this.
Such a great story. So we're moving into the spoiler sections. Last warning.
Okay, so now we're into our spoilery part, Jessen.
Yay.
Let's do Showdown first, baby.
Yes, Showdown. Who's
okay.
going to go first?
I'm going to let you go first.
Okay, I will do my Showdown scene. So I had actually two that I was debating
we
about.
We always do this.
I always like to have a backup just in case I don't want us to have the same scenes.
Right.
But I like, there's two scenes, but I think I'm going to pick one scene. So at the end of the book, they go to 1247 LaRue, which
okay,
is,
so no.
oh, so it's not the same.
No.
Okay. So they go to this address that Alina had carved into the sidewalk and
mm-hmm.
Mac discovers this at the end of the book.
Right.
She goes by herself. She discovers this, it's basically a portal that Fae are coming into the world
mm-hmm.
and she's hiding and she gets caught out. Well, she sees the Lord Master, and she's actually pretty badass at this moment.
Yes.
Barrons drops in, and they're fighting off Fae. She has the spear,
mm-hmm.
and there's this moment where she says that something just clicks in her, and
mm-hmm.
she is just moving on instinct, and she feels good, and she feels like
she's feeling
this
like
is
her
right.
innate power or
right,
something.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And there's a moment whenever she glimpses Barrons looking at her like, what the fuck? Like, totally stunned at what she's doing.
Yeah.
What she's capable of.
Yeah.
Because the whole novel, he's harping on her like, wake her, the fuck up.
You're weak. Yes. You're little.
Like, you're not going to survive. Yes, if you act you're like this, survive. You need to open your eyes. Mm-hmm. And so I really love that moment because it's a real glimpse into where she's going throughout the rest of the series. And I like that she's surprising Barrons this early on. Mm-hmm. And this pretty much foreshadows what their relationship is going to be like. Mac pulling out this inner strength and surprising Barrons over and over and over again. And I loved it because I think it was like the first moment where he truly, truly saw her. You know?
I think he falls a little bit each time.
Yes. He doesn't want to be pulled to her because... No. She's soft
just and a little rainbow girl.
Yes, and just naive, and he's worldly and doesn't have time for this bullshit. But right here, he's like, yeah. Okay,
that is a badass scene.
So what is your showdown
scene?
Okay, I like
it. Okay, so mine is towards the end as well, but it's much softer. It is when she convinces him to paint her nails.
Oh, I love that scene.
She's been all battered and bruised. And,
after
the fight, yes. It's after the fight, and she comes home, and he recounts all of her broken bones, all of her injuries. I've taken care of you. So, and she's thinking, oh, yeah, you've taken care of me because I can't help you or whatever. But then this scene where she convinces him to paint her nail, and she describes him hunched over, this big giant man looking like a Roman centurion.
Yeah.
Painting her nails pink.
It is a quiet moment, and like, if he didn't have to do that.
Exactly. If he was Mr. Big Tough Barrons, would he really be, and didn't care about her, would he really be painting her nails?
I do like that scene too.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Okay.
All right, good one. Whoop. Okay. So let's go straight into the breakdown.
Okay.
Jump into spoilery scenes. Yes. We're going to start deep diving right now.
Okay. Quickly. All right. So the prologue, we have Future Mac tells us right off the bat that the Fae exists. She is a She-Seer. And there's a war going on between two factions, the Seelie and the Unseelie of the Fae.
The big players.
Right. The biggest takeaway from this is that the Unseelie may be worse than the Seelie, but the only good Fae is a dead Fae.
Yeah.
So
this is Future Mac's.
Yes, this is Future Mac's assertion.
She's gone through a lot.
Which she's learned.
Okay, so I just wanted to throw this out there. It's amazing going back and reading this from book one to book five. Do you know what the timeline is?
No.
It is 1 year from book one to book five. Only a year passes and so much fucking happens. It's crazy.
And
so
this Future book Mac is like 2 weeks or 3 weeks or something.
This
it's
book
like nothing.
This book only goes through a timeline of 2 weeks and so much fucking happens.
It's
so
insane.
I think her transformation is even more astonishing once you figure out that that's the timeline.
Right.
So anyway, I thought that was just cool rereading it.
That is cool.
So this is Mac before Alina's death. She's from Ashford, Georgia, a very small town. She has two loving parents, wonderful sister who's studying abroad at Trinity College in Dublin. She doesn't really have a direction in life. She likes life simple. She just likes it that way. She wants to go to community college.
Girl.
Yeah, community college. She doesn't really know what she wants to do. She works as a bartender and she likes upbeat music, a great tan, pink nail polish. She's almost vapid in the way that I do not like my heroines.
Right.
But this is her story. And Karen Marie Moning writes this character so well. It's so relatable because... She's thrust into this world and she's forced to look at herself and be like, okay, I can't just lie around and just
right. And Barrons calls her like this Barbie all the time. And here she is. She is this little vapid Barbie girl living her Barbie world.
She's a little bit spoiled.
You know?
Yeah, she's a little bit spoiled.
Exactly.
She's had a great family life. Her mom is amazing. And she's just been in her little bubble. She
very
really
sheltered,
hasn't traveled
very
anywhere.
Sheltered,
she's not worldly or anything.
Exactly.
So I thought this was also hilarious to read about a Blast from the Past reference to an iPod.
Yes.
An iPod. Like
an iPod?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this book was published in 2006.
Yeah.
And like thinking about it.
Let me go talk to
it,
my friends on MySpace.
Yes. It's so funny. And I just thought it was hilarious that her iPod was on its dock. And I'm like,
I know.
Oh, little iPod.
Dated it. But that's cool.
Yeah, it does. So she gets a call from Dublin saying that her sister was murdered. And in 2 weeks, the case was considered cold. Mm-hmm. Mac is like not fucking having that. She wants answers. She decides to travel to Dublin herself to search for clues, even though her mother forbids her to go. Her mother is just like so distraught at Alina's death, and she's like, right. No, you're not going.
Don't go back there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everyone just seems to accept the fact that there are no answers to be found, but Mac wants answers.
Yeah, this she rocks wants, her world. Yes. She loved her sister so dearly.
Yeah, they're very close.
Right, they were very close, and then all of a sudden she's gone and nobody cares and nobody's doing anything. Yeah. So immediately she's like, you know, this is a life, obviously a life transforming moment, mm-hmm. you know, for anybody. And so I think it's really interesting that we have this pretty little Barbie and suddenly there's this death, you know, of someone yes. she loves so much. And so that immediately changes her.
Turning point.
Right.
Yeah. She wants justice. She wants revenge. Like right. she is out for blood. So she buys a new phone because a couple of days before Alina's death, she had dropped her phone in the pool. And right. so, and she just never got around to replacing it because mm-hmm. she's happy-go-lucky. She goes with the flow and it wasn't really important to her.
Whatever.
Yeah. Well, she gets a new phone and she hears a voice message from Alina.
Can before you imagine she died. Your dead sister?
And she goes over and over in her mind. She's like, I missed the last chance to talk to her before she died.
Because my phone fell in the damn pool.
And she didn't replace it. So right. the message, very interestingly, and I cut a couple parts out just to make it more concise. Right. Everything has gone wrong. I thought I was in love with him and he's one of them. There's so much you don't know. You don't even know what you are. Listen to me. We've got to find the she sadu. Everything depends on it. We can't let them have it. That's just like this yeah. cryptic message.
Hello.
Mac's like, what the fuck? Hell? I don't even know what she's talking about. She even says Mac that had a clue must have died whenever Alina did, because this Mac obviously didn't know the first thing about her sister.
Right.
So this is also rocking her world. Not only is her sister dead, but apparently shit's happened in right. the 4 or 5 months that Alina's been in Dublin that she had no idea. She talked to Alina on the phone. She's never mentioned anything.
She never mentioned a boyfriend or anything. Nothing. Or anything
and
unusual.
All of a sudden she's in love and what's going on?
I know. Okay, so she hightails her ass over to Dublin.
Yeah, she's right? like, let me get to the bottom of this.
You know, she leaves her little sheltered world and gets over there. And we're there pretty quickly in the mm-hmm. story. This is all within the first chapter or so. So she stops in a pub and sees an impossibly beautiful man filching a bottle of whiskey and nobody notices. But the funny thing is like as she's staring at him, she senses that his beauty is an illusion. It's some sort of mask for decay. She can't quite describe it. It's just a right. feeling.
It's like our first hints that something's going on.
She's getting like her tingly spidey sense is starting to work.
Yeah.
And she's just staring and eyeballing this mm-hmm. dude, right? And so this old woman come in like raps her on the head saying that Mac is going to jeopardize them all with the way she's staring at him. And she name drops. She says that Dwaha Day. It's short for the Dwaha Day Donnan, you know. Yeah. And calls her an O'Connor. And she's like, what the fuck? My name isn't O'Connor. And what are you talking about using these weird words? Okay. So she goes and visits Alina's apartment, her sister, and it looks ransacked. But she can't handle it at this point. Her grief is just too much, too fresh.
And right. so she walks right back out.
So she doesn't spend any time there. She leaves. And she just spends the day searching for the term Alina mentioned in her message, the she sadu. She, you know, looks on the computers. She keeps coming up empty because Gaelic spellings are a nightmare.
Yeah. Trying to spell it out yeah. phonetically is like, yeah. you're not.
She sadu is not spelled.
You're missing a ton. You're missing a ton of consonants that are completely silent and yeah. don't make sense.
Just like the Tawaha Day. Look up that pronunciation, people. But she does find out that the Tawaha Day, because she talks to a couple of local dudes. And yeah. they're like, oh, you're talking about the fairies.
Yeah, wee little fairies.
The wee little fairies. That's what you're talking about. You know, they're just some drunk dudes at a bar or whatever.
Yeah.
So she dismisses the old woman as crazy. And then, of course, she keeps wandering. So she leaves that pub and she gets lost in the fog. Okay.
Yeah, she was thinking, you know, whatever.
She's just thinking and like trying to figure everything out.
Right.
You know?
And have you ever experienced whenever you're driving in a car yes. and then all of a sudden you're in a section of the road where you're like, I yeah. think I just like checked out the last 20 minutes of driving. How did I get here?
I do this way too often.
I do too. I know. I'm like, I'm just daydreaming
about it's usually romance books yeah. too.
So and, that's what happens. She just gets all of a sudden she finds herself.
She's thinking
lost
and she's
fog.
Just lost. Right. And then she kind of finds herself sort of a dilapidated area. It's very dark. There's no mm-hmm. street lights.
Yes.
Eventually, this will be called the dark zone. And she ends up, she sees some small lights on at this little bookstore. So she needs to call a cab because she doesn't even...
Yeah, she's so relieved. She's like, oh, this well-lit bookstore.
Cute little bookstore, yes. Barron's Books and Baubles. Uh-huh. And if that isn't faded, come on. And so she pops in there. And so there's a woman behind the counter. Her name's Fiona, who we meet for the first time here. Lots to say about her later. And she asks her, what does the Shisa do? Okay, and she gets this immediate reaction from Fiona, this shocked.
First reaction she's ever had to this word.
Yes, it's a look of alarm. And you don't want to know anything about that sort of thing. And then all of a sudden she hears this very deep voice behind her, basically asking, you know.
What do you want to know about this?
What do you want to know about the Shisa do? Okay, so Jericho Barrons, we see him for the first time. Mac immediately goes on the defensive when he starts to question her because he asks a bunch of questions.
Oh, yeah.
Where have you heard this before?
Yeah, what's your full name?
Who are you?
Where are you from?
Just like, what the fuck, dude? Yeah. Who are you?
His presence is amazing.
Oh, my God. The way she describes his presence and all things, charged energy and all this stuff. Like, she even says, the room had been full of books before. Now it was full of him. It was just his presence is large and in charge.
It is all-encompassing. Jericho Barrons is like the alpha.
Oh, God.
He's so alpha, it's insane.
I know.
So, obviously, he knows what the word means. Yeah. But they both don't want to give up their information. So, Mac just leaves. The cab gets there, and she's like, fucking peace out. Like, I'm not letting you know anything.
Bunch of weirdos.
I don't trust you. Which is good. I like that. She's like, I don't know you, and I'm not going to give you information.
I'm glad. Yeah, I'm glad we didn't get this typical, let me spill my whole story to you, and you can help me.
No, I like the antagonistic relationship. Mm-hmm. Between her and Barrons. She senses something about him, doesn't trust it, and I like that.
Yeah, she's not quite an idiot.
Yeah. But Barrons appears at her hotel room at 2 a.m. and wants to exchange information. Like, what the fuck, dude? He is intense and circles her so that his back is never to the door, which is this is something you notice about Barrons throughout the rest of the series. Like, he will never be in the vulnerable position.
No.
He is trained like that. It's awesome. I love these little tells.
Me too.
So he tells Mac, he gives up a little bit of information. He tells her how to spell the Shisa do. And also tells her, just go home, Miss Lane. Be young, be pretty, get married, have babies, grow old with your pretty husband.
Oh, God. It was so condescending.
And that stings Mac. But she stands her ground. She's like, oh, fuck no. I know you did not say
you
that.
You did not.
No, yeah. And he tells her that it's a book and that countless people would kill to possess it. And Mac's like, people for killing to possess a book? Yeah, like, what the fuck?
What
anyway.
What the hell?
So she, in turn, gives him some information, tells him about Alina's murder. That's why she's here.
Right.
And eventually plays him the message. Because she didn't want to give this to him, but she does play it because she wants to watch his face and decide if he had anything to do with her murder.
Right,
I thought that was so smart.
She's gonna
look
at his reaction and observe.
Yes.
Can she tell if he's been involved in some way?
Right. I really like that.
Yeah.
So before he leaves, he puts Mac in an unbreakable hold and insists she goes home. He moves like lightning fast and calls her a walking victim.
I love in that part because she had left the door open so she would be safe. And she said she realized then that leaving the door open, like,
it was like a placebo.
Yeah.
Like,
she was never safe.
Yeah,
with him,
no, never.
Ever.
He was always in charge and
always
she
in
was
control.
Not. Yes, exactly. So the next day she visits the college that Alina was going to.
Right.
And Trinity College finds out that her sister rarely came to class after the first few months in Dublin and that she had a boyfriend, but they never saw him. And this is not typical of Alina at all. She's studious. She loves school. So Mac is just so confused about the person that her sister is.
Right. Alarm bells have to be going off.
Like, oh, yeah.
I didn't even sense any of this going on with my sister.
And she kind of blames. She's like, was I not paying attention?
Right.
Was there something in her voice?
Should I
ask more questions? Mm-hmm. And it's just, I couldn't even imagine that.
Like, I can't either. It's
looking in hindsight.
The
what could
emotion
I have done?
That is just woven through that relationship, even though I know obviously the sisters not in any of the scenes, but it's so good.
It is
It's so good.
So she does research the spelling now that she has the correct spelling for the Shisa do. And it tells her it's a dark hollow belonging to the mythical race of the Fae and is one of four Dark Hollows. Mm-hmm. The Mirror from Spell of the Highlander is another, yes, and we reviewed that in episode 4.
Right,
exactly. So that, we've already seen a Dark Hollow if you've listened to our Spell of the Highlander episode. We also find out that there's also four Light Hollows, mm-hmm, and one makes its appearance in this book. There is a throwaway line, which I love so much. It's like Karen Marie Moning is just like, she's so cheeky. Max says she's thinking about all this like woo-woo magical stuff and, yeah, how her and Alina don't believe in that. Right. And she says, give me creature comforts over a hulking Highlander with the manners of a caveman any day. Which is hilarious because Karen Marie Moning's Highlander series all about
the cavemen
Highlanders.
It's
great.
Literally throwing them over their shoulders and carrying them off, yes, in many scenes.
So Karen Marie Moning's being a little bit cheeky, and I like it.
I think it's awesome.
Well, Max's reaction to this information is that Barron's fucking lied to,
yes,
her. Like, this, yes, is stupid. This is mythology. This is make-believe. Yeah, and this she is pissed.
Like, right, exactly. This is mythology. So she is pissed off. So she heads back to the bookstore, bangs on the door, and she hears Barron's voice in the night behind her. Okay, so she kind of turns around. She thinks he's like, there's this shadow. You know, she can't quite see who it is, what it is. But she talks to the shadow a little bit, like, what the hell are you talking about? And
she's staring at a shadow, but whenever he appears,
yeah, he's right beside
her.
He's
not the shadow.
Yeah, she looks back and is like, the shadow's still there. Oh, shit, yes, what the hell?
So something eerie's going on.
Something's going on. So again, she's getting all the creepy feels. But Barron wants to know what she saw. But of course, Mac is not trusting.
No. She never gives up her information, and I think that's what I love about Mac.
I know.
Is she's like, I'm not giving up any information for free. You're, yeah, gonna, it's gonna have to be an even exchange.
This is when he threatens her, like,
oh, yeah,
sort of physically crowds or restrains her.
Yeah, and the hand on the neck.
That hand on the throat.
Yes.
He has his hand in her hair and his hand on her throat.
Oh,
it,
yeah,
is so primitive, predatory. Yeah. He also, this is the first time, his eyes drop a little bit, like, over her face and down her body a little bit.
Yeah, because Mac is blessed in the boobage department.
Yeah, she's quite blessed.
Yeah.
And so
he definitely runs his eyes over them.
And, you know, she's
over,
like,
the girls.
As if.
Yeah.
Like, so she tells him about the shadows, and then she tells him about the beautiful man she saw at the pub, you know, and he tells her what she is. This is the first time she finds out you're a she-seer. You know, you're able to see the fae.
Right.
You can see them where other people cannot. And so he offers to help her, but she refuses. She's still like,
because
what?
She's untrained. He's, yeah, like, I never thought that there was one like you out,
yeah,
there.
Yeah, he's like, I didn't know there would be another one out there. He's
who's
like,
not trained.
Yeah, and he's like, you must have lived in some remote provincial,
yes,
no place, which of
and
course
she was
did.
Like, yeah,
this I little did. Bitty town in southern Georgia, you know? So there were no fae over there wandering about,
yeah,
the streets.
So I like how Mac refuses because she's like, why should I trust this person who, yeah, literally, like, threw me against a wall and,
yeah, you're, like,
is
threatening
me?
Like, dude,
yeah,
you know, she's not that. I mean, she's.
He's not giving her any reason to really trust him.
Exactly.
You know,
giving her little tidbits of information, you,
yeah,
know, it's not enough.
No.
Okay. So then she leaves, right? But then she sees the gray man. She's like in another pub. She sees who we'll learn is called the gray man, who sucks the beauty from a woman and pretends like she can't. But she pretends she can't see his true form. Like, she's staring at him and he's like this beautiful blonde god. And then all of a sudden he shifts.
Yeah. They have a glamour.
Right.
That they can.
This illusion that.
They have an illusion to project an image that they're normal.
Right.
That they're a normal but insanely beautiful,
right,
person. But Max, since she's a she-seer, she can see beyond the glamour,
right,
especially now that she knows.
Like,
and now
she's opening
she knows up
that
to
they're
this
dangerous.
World.
She's like, oh my God, I have to pretend I don't see him. He's disgusting. She just talks about how disgusting he is, and he's literally sucking the life out of this,
right,
woman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what does she do? She runs back to the bookstore.
Yeah.
Because she's finally starting to believe. This is where Barron starts kind of like challenging her.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you, Miss Lane, a survivor or a victim? You know, and he's willing to make her into a survivor to help her, to train her, to, you know, help her survive this world. But she's still, like, you know, just
she's
being
stubborn.
Defiant.
She's
very
stubborn.
She's distrustful. She's like,
but she has reason to be, yeah. Which is why I don't mind her being stubborn.
I don't either.
Since it's first person POV, you really get a sense of what's going on, what's going through her mind.
It's all believable. Like, she's been thrust into this world. Everybody's being total asshat to her.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, how else are you going
to... Yeah, she's here to find her sister's murderer, and then all of a sudden there's these, like, fairies and shit, and she's like, what the fuck?
I know.
Like, it's just a lot to fucking process.
And then I want to trust this dude, Mr. Dark and Deadly over here with blood on his hands? Yeah. What?
No.
So he tells Mac that the Seelie were the ones who had been permitted into our realm, but now the Unseelie, the bad guys, are making their way here. That the gray man is one of them.
Yeah.
He also tells her that the queen is missing,
which is Avil, and we see her in Spell of the Highlander. Yes. So we've met her before. You get her in all the Highlander books. Basically, she makes an appearance.
Right. So Mac is still in denial. He gives her a crash course in, like, fae terms.
Yeah, like glamour, all that type of stuff.
Right.
And the shades, which is the shadows that she was actually seeing whenever she thought it was Barrons.
Right.
Who, like, travel through the dark zone.
Right. And he says that the true vision runs in bloodlines, and Alina, his sister, must have had it too and been killed by a fae that she had seen.
Which makes total sense, honestly.
Right.
Like, that.
So now she's like, okay, because she knew that there was something menacing about that creature, the gray man.
Right.
Like, obviously.
Exactly.
You know.
So... she returns to Alina's apartment to search for her journal because both Alina, whenever she was at home, she kept these detailed journals about everything that happened in her life. And Mac's like, I need to find this journal. She would have written about this stuff.
Right.
And maybe there's some clues to her murderer. So she goes and she's on the way to the apartment and she crashes into an Unseelie.
This is
a big deal because whenever the Unseelie, Fae, in any Fae in general, whenever the Fae project a glamour, people who are not she-seers just kind of move around them, you know?
Yeah, they instinctually move around them, but they don't touch them,
and they're not aware of them.
Right.
But since she is a she-seer, that glamour doesn't work on her, and so she runs into him. That's a big deal. It's basically like, giveaway.
Yeah, just like, oh, so sorry.
It's and a then dead giveaway that she is a she-seer,
and
she's in trouble, and she can see the look on his face. And
and he's disgusting.
The next time we see her, she is going through BB&B again. Like, she like always bat out of hell. And Barrons is like, what the fuck happened now? And so she recounts it. And he was like, well, how did you escape? And she was like, I don't know. I just kind of, he just froze and I left. And he's like, haha, tell me what really happened.
Yeah, he's like confused and froze. Well,
Fiona is listening in and Fiona's like, come on, you know what this is. Like, and he was like, well,
no.
A null.
It's a myth.
That's a myth, a null.
Yeah.
So Mac is a null. She has this powers where her touch, whenever she touches purposefully a fae, she can freeze them for an amount of time. So that's how she was able to get away.
That's awesome.
Good thing. So Barrons insists that now she has to stay at Barrons Books and Baubles and change her hair because then Seelie will be looking for her now because they hunt she-seers.
Yeah.
And when she goes downstairs after cutting her long blonde hair off and dyeing it dark, she feels nauseous while she's going downstairs.
Yeah.
And whenever she approaches Barrons, who's just like sitting on the couch with papers scattered on the table, she's like dry heaving. Well, apparently she can sense the dark book. And this, she's just become very useful to Barrons.
I know.
She can sense the thing that he's after the most.
Yes.
She can actually sense anything that's fae. And this makes her believe Barrons is also a she-seer because he can also see the fae and he knows so much about it too.
And he also says a lot of things when he's like, oh, you'll get over it. The nausea, it'll go away.
Yeah.
Like,
so he's very knowledgeable and that's an easy assumption to make. Mm-hmm. Barrons takes her to a few big players to find out if they have the dark book or any other OOPS, as Mac calls them, oops. I love saying that. They're objects of power.
Objects of power.
Objects of power. And so they visit these big players in the Dublin area. Mm-hmm. There's a brief mention of Lucan Trevane's collection from Spell of the Highlander. Barrons had wanted something from his collection, maybe the Dark Mirror. I don't know.
That's what I was thinking.
Who knows? Yeah. Maybe he wanted to use Kian's knowledge of something.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, how do you pronounce the guy who is the vampire?
Okay, I said Maluke.
Okay,
because it has a little accent at the end.
It does. It does have an accent on the E. I just started calling him Malice because he's full of malice. That's just how I say it now in my head. So anyway, they go to his house and he's like, Barrons does say he's supposedly a vampire, and Mac does witness him like throw a guy across the room. And so she's like, well, I mean, I don't know if he is or not, but that's like
that
not normal.
Requires strength.
I love this scene because whenever they're leaving and Barrons is like, we're going to have to come back and search this whole ground, this whole area, because it like it's so many acres. And she's like, I totally picked this up. She basically swipes something.
I got something.
She swipes something from underneath Malice's eyes, and it happens to be one of the four stones needed to read the dark book. Yeah. And Barrons has another one. And so, hey, Mac, she has some good
skills.
And
I like that too, because it surprised Barrons. He's like, oh,
yeah, like,
shit.
Oh, shit.
Awesome.
You're resourceful a little bit.
But then he's like, but you just outed yourself, and now they're going to know, you know? And she's like, dude, like, give me some credit, you know?
So this is the first Rainbow Girl mentioned because she is wearing a rainbow skirt. And I just love it.
Calls her Miss Rainbow.
Yes. The next day, she has a first run-in with Valaine.
Oh,
Prince
Valaine.
Of the Sealy Court. He is a death by sex fae. This is what she labels this cast of fae.
Death
by sex. Because whenever these type of fae are in the vicinity, these high, like, basically consider them royalty.
Mm-hmm.
They just make you want to have sex.
Yeah, it's like
she's like walking down the street and she wants to lift up her shirt. Like,
yeah,
it's just like
she keeps trying. What am I doing?
Yeah, she keeps, like, describes it as immolation by orgasm. Like, this is what she's. It's like involuntary. Well, he knows who Mac is.
Yes.
He's aware of her presence. Yes. He asks Mac to find the dark book on behalf of Avil.
Mm-hmm.
He also offers her the cuff of Cruz so that she can contact him.
And protect her.
And protect her.
Yes.
And Mac, ever the skeptic, and this is so awesome. Like, if she would have just accepted this, I would have been like, oh my God, girl.
Then she would have been in the too stupid to live category.
Yes. So, she's like, what's the catch? And he's like, no catch. And she's like, no, I don't believe you.
Yeah,
so she
you're
refuses.
A liar.
She refuses. Yeah. Good job, Mac.
Right. So she, so that was her first experience with Valaine. She heads back to the bookstore. She overhears Barrons and Fiona talking in the bookstore one night.
Eavesdropping.
Yeah. She's like coming down the stairs or whatever, and she hears this conversation between them. It's very heated on Fiona's side. He's very calm, but she is angry, and she says, she doesn't belong here. You can't let her stay. I won't stand for it. And Barrons is like, you dare to tell me what to do? Like, seriously? And so he ends up telling her, you stay out of this or leave. I'm sure I can find another to serve my needs. You know. And so we know that
she is
Fiona's his booty call.
Oh, yeah. She's so put out about that. She's like, serve your needs.
You know,
is
that
what
I
do?
Okay, I am jealous. I am. She even admits her jealousy. And he's like, I'll have none of it. He's like, you know, you've known all along what this was.
The status quo.
Yeah. This is not a
relationship. Yeah. Don't build me up in your mind to be something that I'm not.
I love that, too. I love when he warns her not to do that, because later in other books, he's very different with, you know, the one he loves.
Right.
So obviously it sounds like she's in love with Barrons, and she seems to be, and he could just take her or leave her, like, find a replacement. I don't care. Right. And then Barrons uses voice for the first time on Fiona, which is this controlling power.
This is something that you would catch if you've read the Highlander books.
Right.
Because
they use voice.
Voice is used by
the
Adam
Druids.
Black. Voice is used by the Kelter brothers and also by Kian. So it's not explicitly stated that he is using voice, but you can tell because Mac says that Fiona's voice in response
changes. It becomes
becomes dreamy, and all of a sudden she's like
very
accepting.
Compliant.
Yes.
Extremely compliant. Like, whatever you
say,
Barrons.
So I love that. I love that she doesn't spell it out, but that's what he's doing. He's using voice on her.
Right. Yeah. It's never said, because then Mac doesn't even know what that is.
No.
At this point, you know, she's obviously still struggling with her. She's her status.
Yeah.
She starts thinking about that old woman. Who said, about honor your bloodline and all these, like, weird, crazy things at the time.
Yeah, it's such a weird statement.
You're like, what are you talking about? You know, but because she's confused because her parents don't have this ability. She's like, my parents, they don't, what is she talking about?
Yeah.
You know? So she starts thinking that maybe Alina was a null too, and a fae tricked her into thinking she was in love, and maybe that's how this all happened, and she just fell down this rabbit hole of doom.
There's just a lot of thoughts going through her mind. Like, what? she's trying to piece together this information.
Right.
And trying to see what happened to Alina. That's her main focus in all of this.
Right. So our next visit that Barrons takes her on is to see Rocky O'Banion, the Irish Catholic mobster.
Oh, yeah.
His description is like really interesting.
It is like so...
It's like frightening.
Sinister. Yes. And...
But also she said he just exudes like sexual charisma. Like you would want to talk, if he asked you to talk to him or bring you hither, you would just want to. You know, he's like that kind of compelling person. And she even says, from the way he was trying to pave his way to heaven by plastering over his sins with the putty of religious zeal, he was also a borderline psychopath.
Yeah, because she said that about him. The rumors about him is that he'd like wiped out whole families of like other rival gangs. And then all of a sudden he just popped up. He just popped up and he was ready to take control of all of Dublin. And so... In his mansion, they just have all of these religious icons, this artwork, these priceless artifacts from, his Catholic upbringing. And she's like, this guy is a psycho. He has so much blood on his hands, but he's so religious.
And he also, Mac also notices that Barrons is acting a little different around him. Laughing in a very general sort of, sort of a good mood, playful. He's not as like...
Oh, well, that's because Mac is wearing that dress Fiona had gotten her a dress.
And it's very cleavage revealing.
Barrons had said, he wants Mac to wear grown-up clothes because she doesn't...
dress like a woman.
She doesn't dress...
That's what he says.
I would say that her style would probably be, like, conservative Southern.
Yeah.
And she likes pretty things.
Very feminine, like, very soft feminine.
And so this
but
is, like,
Barrons
this
hangs
tight,
out with, like... Yeah.
This is this tight black dress. And Mac is, like, has to, like, hold her boobs whenever... He's like driving on
like
the bumps.
Like bouncing,
they're like
all
jiggling
over the place
or whatever. And so that's a big reason why Barrons is acting different. And that's...
Yeah. And I did like the part when he starts, when O'Banion gets a little interested in her.
Oh, yeah.
And he asks, is she Catholic? And he goes, no, she's Protestant, but she is Catholic.
Yeah. Mac says that's a lie, but I didn't bother correcting him because I don't want Brocky O'Banion
but
to
the
turn
fact
my
that,
way.
But the fact that Barrons said it immediately was he does not want him to have any interest in
possessive.
His woman. Yes,
possessive.
Exactly. Exactly. She does detect an object of power, one of the oops, while they're there.
I love it. She, like, acts like she trips over the threshold and says, oops, to, like, tell
to
Barrons.
To warn Barrons. Oops.
Like, there is an object of power somewhere here.
Yep. So they go back later that night. They crawl through, like, I don't know, sewers and all kinds of crazy stuff. And they get the Spear of Longinus. Is that how you pronounce it?
I don't know. I think Longinus? It has to be like some
Longinus?
Sort of Latinus.
Yeah, it's
Latin
obviously Latin.
Because they said Barrons
it's
tells
probably
her
Longinus
that.
Or something.
Yeah.
But it's actually a light hallow and a weapon that can kill all fae. We find that it was actually also the spear that, was pierced into Jesus upon his death. But that it
I like her reaction
that,
to that information. She's like, this killed Jesus?
This killed Jesus. He's like, he was already dead. She's like, I'm not that religious, but I immediately wanted to like throw the spear out and run to a church and pray.
Right,
and
right.
It was a really funny scene. But find out that it was a light hallow before that. It had power before that even. So, and he reveals to her that the weapon is for her. Barrons has gotten it for her to protect her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And he wants her to like carry it around with her all the time. He's like, find a way to make it compact and you carry that because it can kill Fae and you need this protection.
Right. The problem is as soon as they lift it, Barrons knows they've triggered alarms. They hightail it out of there. But when they're exiting the area, a cop sees them and sees their faces.
Right.
So and he knows.
He's on the payroll of Rocky.
Yes.
So
all the cops
they're going to get
payroll.
Reported.
Right. So when they get back, Barrons turns off all exterior lights of the bookstore. And he's like, he tells her, go to your room. Do not come out.
So this is the layout of the bookstore.
Yeah.
It's on the edge of the dark zone.
Right.
The dark
One
zone
side is the dark
are
zone.
These like... abandoned streets. Nobody goes there. They're forgotten streets in
Dublin.
They're
disappearing off maps.
Right, exactly. And they're owned by the Shades.
Right.
The Shades don't like light. So Barrons Books and Baubles all around the exterior of the building are floodlights.
Mm-hmm.
And so they don't come to Barrons. It's like Barrons Books and Baubles is like the last fortress between the dark zone and the regular world. And so whenever they go back, he turns those lights off.
I know.
I love it.
It's so good.
So simple. It's so simple and so effective. It's
awesome.
Amazing.
But the shades don't bother Barrons.
The shades don't bother Barrons. Yeah. But whenever Rocky and Cokin get the spear, they all freaking die.
Yeah, there's like 13 or 16 of them or something.
Barrons didn't even have to lift a finger.
Nope.
And so whenever Mac finds out that how That's dangerous the shades actually are.
She the next day when she sees like all these piles of clothes where men stood.
Like open, the doors of the car are like open, you know, whenever you leave your car door open, it like dings.
And you can hear like the little ding, ding,
yes,
ding.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. There's like a Maybach and she's like, what the fuck? Like obviously nobody would just leave these cars. They're all dead. And she's like, I'm buying a lot of flashlights to carry around and stash around the bookstore, which is an important thing that happens in later books.
Yes.
Like, good job, Mac.
I know.
So Barrons wants her to look for oops at the museum because that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
If they would be anywhere, it'd be a museum.
Right.
So anyway, she slips up while they're talking and because he's like telling her to be careful or whatever. And she slips up and says that all fae are monsters, even the pretty ones. But she doesn't tell Barrons about Vlaine because he keeps secrets too.
I like that he's like, what do you mean?
Yeah. What do you mean the pretty ones?
I thought she said he'd only seen the ugly ones.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
So she doesn't give up all her information. She's like, no, he keeps secrets. I'm not telling him everything either.
Yeah.
Max says that this new fae world seems hell-bent on trying to kill her, which I'm like, yep, pretty much. Barron's response is amazing. He says, I don't think you understand, Miss Lane. I won't let it kill you no matter what. It's so telling. So telling.
Yes.
It's not just because she can detect the dark book. It's not just that. And the subtlety, nothing spelled out very clearly. Yeah. But yeah, he's definitely, she's intriguing at the moment. So Vlaine appears at the museum and she like starts taking off her clothes and he like almost rapes her, which is horrible.
Yeah.
Before that happens, though, this is a little bit of a funny moment, not the rape part. This is she's going through the museum and she sees something on the floor and she's like, oh, look at these cute pink panties on the floor. And then she's like, wait, those are my freaking panties.
That was funny.
It was funny.
I was like, wait,
and then Vlaine appears, and this is where you get the sense that the Fae really don't have they don't operate on the same level as
they have
we
no
do.
Respect for humans at
they
all.
They don't have morals. They don't have qualms about right or wrong.
Right.
They just take.
They take what
they
want.
They take because they're powerful.
Yes.
And
it's a very sinister scene.
Yes. Mac actually breaks it off.
Yeah.
Because she thinks about Alina. Like, that's how she breaks her spell. Because, I mean, the power that they throw
her
off
around her.
I mean, he was literally right behind her and it was about to happen.
Yeah.
She says, this is another reason why this dual POV with future Mac and present Mac is so intriguing because she says, one day I would stop taking off my clothes in Vlaine's presence, but the cost of that resistance would be a piece of my soul. And it's like, what happens? Mac is pissed. And when Vlaine asks what she took from O'Banion's, she flashes the spear at him and he vanishes.
Yep.
He looked afraid and it makes Mac feel really good. She's like, okay, I definitely have this weapon that is going to be effective on all levels of fate, even this most powerful one that, you know, has such control over me. Interestingly enough, at the museum, the old woman witnessed all of this and didn't help her.
That pissed me off so much.
Oh, my God. It pissed Mac off, too. And the old woman justifies it by saying, well, I thought you were Priya. And Mac's like, what the fuck is Priya?
What are you talking about?
And she's just so pissed. She's like crying. It was embarrassing for her.
Yeah, it's humiliating. All these people like saw her, you know.
Right.
It's just.
After Vlaine vanished.
Yeah.
So Mac doesn't know the rules. And she's like, I'm not an O'Connor. Why do you keep saying that? And the old woman's like, well, you are an O'Connor. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
And she's like, well, you must be adopted because Mac's like, my mom's normal. But no. And she's like, no, I'm not adopted. She's like, fuck off, old woman. So she's back at the bookstore and she's verbally sparring with Barrons. And
because he knows she's something's
mad.
Wrong,
yeah,
too.
She's mad. She's aggravated at the whole situation. And she's sparring with Barrons and she feels like she wants to kiss him. But she blames this on Vlaine's earlier effects. Like the residual effects
of, you know.
But it's not.
Right.
But so Barrons wants to train Mac to use her null abilities with the spear to kill Unseelie because that would make her less vulnerable.
Right.
She doesn't tell him about what happened with Lane, but this is just an obvious progression in her training. So one night they go out and they find the gray man, and she kills it with a little bit of difficulty. The scene's really funny. Barron's is like, yeah, you need he's to like, learn
look,
some lessons.
He's like, look, I'm right here and nothing will happen to you, but I want you to go for it first, you know?
Yeah, he like, lets her dangle in a uncomfortable position for a while. She also does use the word that she heard the old woman say, Priya. She's like, okay, from context clues, I think I know what this, it means like you're like, so, like a sex-obsessed.
Sex slave or something. Yeah,
for the Fae.
Right.
And so that's how she gets close to the gray man. And she just doesn't know exactly what it means, but she's pretty smart cookie. And before the gray man dies, he insinuates that the Lord Master killed Alina. He says something about your sister or the other she-seer, whatever.
Threatening
and
her.
And so this is...
You're going to die just like her and all
this
stuff.
There are always these little hints about what happened to Alina. Just little breadcrumbs throughout the story. It just keeps it going. But obviously, this first book really focuses on Mac's journey and her discovery
of
this
what
other
she is.
Side of her.
Right. So Mac ends up calling the hospital where she was born to find out anything she can. But there are no records of her or Alina being born at the hospital.
Yeah.
So she calls her dad to ask. And he doesn't deny, but he doesn't confirm, which, of course, is devastating to her.
Yeah. I couldn't even imagine. Just like your whole world is just being turned upside down, just like day after day, something new happens.
For her, it was enough to confirm, you know.
Yes.
Her dad briefly mentions that someone might have warned them not to let Alina or Mac travel to Ireland, but wouldn't say anymore, you know.
There's so many clues.
So
it's
many
insane.
And so many like little cryptic things. So she finally goes to the alley where Alina's body was found. When she does, she starts sort of searching and looking around the rubble or whatever. She finds in a dress carved on the stones with a nail file, and knowing her sister had to have left that for her with 1247 LaRue.
Right. And after the address, it says Junior, which is what Alina called Mac. She always called Mac Junior. So she knows, like, this is a clue
meant for me.
She's trying to tell me something.
Right. So so she goes to the precinct and shows Detective O'Duffy. But of course, you know, because she wants them to open the case. She's still hoping, open the case. My sister's murdered, you know. But he dismisses it because he's like, there's no street like that in Dublin. There is no LaRue. This is all nothing, you know.
It's not new information to O'Duffy. He's like, we checked this out, but it's not. There's no street name here.
But they just don't realize it because it's sort of been wiped off the map.
Yeah.
So Mac recalls that Barron says that people are forgetting whole sections of the city. So she digs up a map that's 5 years old. Okay.
Yes.
And she finds the address.
Yes.
Where is it? It's right smack dab in the middle of the shade territory.
Yeah.
The dark zone.
It's in the dark zone.
The bookstore.
Behind BB&B. It's
right.
Like 14 blocks that just like are no
just
longer
nothing.
On current maps.
Right. And it's like there's like an illusion or something. Most people don't even see it.
Right.
You know, it's like just disappear to the human
eye. Yeah, people just gravitate away from it.
Yeah. So Mac sees Barron's walk through the dark zone one night without flashlights, and the shades left him alone.
Oh, yeah. This is like red flag to her. She's like, what the fuck are you?
Yeah, she's like, I finally had my answer to whether or not I could trust him. That would be a great big nut.
Yeah. This is where the turning point of the story really starts. It starts amping up.
Yeah.
She decides to travel alone to the address.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where KMM, she does such a good job with the character. I've said it again and again. Mac could so easily be a too stupid to live character. Like, why are you making these decisions?
Yeah.
But future Mac tells us that she's surprised that she even survived going into the neighborhood that night.
Mm-hmm.
And she explains it away in hindsight, saying, maybe I was numb from so many shocks. Maybe after everything I'd lost so recently, I just didn't care.
And I can see that. Like,
yes,
I can totally relate to that.
She
finally
has this clue. Nobody's fucking listening to her. She can't trust this guy because
she's on her own.
He's something other and won't tell her what.
Right.
And so she's like, I'm going to do this and I'm just going to go.
Right.
So, and I like this line too. We start to see this new Mac really taking hold because she's been resistant to this idea that she's a she-seer. She doesn't want this.
She doesn't want to be a
part of this world. Mm-hmm. She doesn't want this complication. Like I said, she wants the
simple life.
Yeah,
she starts to wish it away.
Right. And she says rainbows need sunshine to exist, and there hadn't been a lot of a lot of that in my world lately. Yep. And so this is Mac starting to get a little bit harder, a little yes. bit more world weary and not mm-hmm. as optimistic. And she's going to need that. Yeah. She's already changed so much in the last 2 weeks since she's arrived in Dublin. Now she wears dark clothes and she has the dark hair, right. short hair, short, no hair, makeup. No she makeup. Carries a weapon.
Right.
It's just so much different. This is Mac 2.0.
Yep.
So she arrives at the address. It's actually a huge brick house in the middle of like a warehouse district. It basically mm-hmm. sticks out because it's the only like house.
Right.
So she goes inside. And this is a little hint for everyone who's read the entire series. The inside has black and white marble floors, mm-hmm. which I'm going to go into a little bit spoiler details at the end of this for the whole time, for the whole series, and just like harp on how amazing KMM is with leaving these breadcrumbs. So she goes into one of the upstairs bedrooms. She finds Alina's photo albums and she sees the transformation of her sister and the man she's in love with. Like she sees like the timeline whenever Alina's just taking pictures right. around Dublin, and then all of a sudden 4 months in, she starts There's changing something. And she's yes. like, she looks like she's in love. She's looking at the person who's taking this picture and she right. looks different. And she sees and she a picture sees of the man of and him. She's like, he is beautiful. Mm-hmm. He has waist-length copper hair. He's tall. He's insanely attractive. And he has this scar from his cheekbone to his mouth. Mm-hmm. And she's like, this is insane how nobody could really tell me, give me a description of who this guy is. Mm-hmm. And whenever you look at him, it's like,
who would miss him?
Yes.
And so how could you not, like,
I mean, something's
remember
going
this guy.
Yeah. So she has this, but then she feels this pull towards the back of the house. Like she's mm-hmm. feeling this like nauseous feeling, which this was so interesting. Whenever she's first walking through the dark zone and she hasn't yet found BB&B, like mm-hmm. at the beginning of the book, she feels nauseous and she thinks it's because she's nervous about being lost and she's like, where am I? She right. literally passed by this house in the beginning yes. of the book.
Yeah.
She was feeling nauseous. She passed by this place because whenever she goes back behind the house and goes into this warehouse, she sees this dolmen, like these megaliths, and she's like, mm-hmm. how the fuck did this get here?
Yeah.
And Unseelie are pouring out, and a cloaked figure is opening and closing the portal and letting them into the world. So this is like a big deal. She passed by this place where all these Unseelie were just pouring in. It's so insane that she was there already. It was right under her nose. The answer to her questions is right there. So chaos ensues after.
Mac is spotted by Malice, Maluche, whatever his name is.
Maluche. Maluche. How Malaka. The fuck you say it? Malaka, we don't know.
The vampire. Oh my God, stop. And he's been missing from the public eye for a while. He sort of disappeared and fell yeah. off the radar, right?
Mac, Barrons like to keep track of all the players.
Right, and he said he's been missing, and somebody powerful has told him to come hither, and he's disappeared. So she reacts quickly and touches every Unseelie within her range, you know, nulling them, you know.
Yeah, with she just reacts on instinct.
Her freeze capabilities.
Right.
And Vampire tells the Lord Master that Mac is another null, and Mac asks if they knew Alina.
Yeah, that's her gut reaction. She's right. like, wait, you knew Alina, like another null that has to yeah. be Alina.
Yeah, and so she reveals that she's Alina's sister, and the Lord Master said that he knew she would come and that they are going to use her to finish what her sister began. So amidst all this mayhem, Barrons drops down from the ceiling, a super, super high ceiling, by the way.
Yeah, everyone's like looking up like, where the fuck did you come
like,
from?
Like, did you just fall from the sky? What yeah. the hell just happened? And the Lord Master is Alina's boyfriend, okay? And he isn't registering as Fae,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, Mac is He's like, not registering. Mac is like, what the fuck? The leader yeah. of this army isn't
her
even Fae?
Fae,
like,
even,
what's going on? Yeah,
something is wrong.
Yeah, something's going on.
So, but he leaves when Barrons arrives and sends his cronies to deal with him. Like, he just vanishes.
Yeah.
Okay. And so Mac and Barrons are there fighting off the Unseelie. And she said, I could feel myself turning into something else, and it felt good. At one point, I caught sight of Barron's startled face, and I knew that if he was looking at me like that, I was truly something to see.
Yeah.
Because this is where
my
she's breaking.
Scene.
Yes. This is your
is
showdown
my
scene.
Yes.
Where she's, you know, this is truly Mac 2.0, being yes. badass, fighting them off, using, you know.
This is just a little glimpse into the of what she's future gonna Mac, become. Of future
right,
Mac.
Exactly.
The badass that she's gonna become.
Yes. So she stabs Malice, but he doesn't die like the Sealy. He pushes Mac so hard because he has superhuman strength. Like he backhands her so hard she flies across the room and
lands she's in a like bunch really of hurt. She probably she's has very a concussion.
Hurt. Yeah. Yeah, and he knocks her enough, like, even later, Barrons is like, I thought he broke your cheekbone. Yeah. You know, like, he really hit her hard.
Well, he broke a lot of shit. He did. We'll find that out, but...
But when he does this, Barrons screams out, Mac! You
know? Which is so amazing, because he normally is very formal and calls her Miss Lane.
Only calls her Miss Lane. And I think that's also a barrier, keeping her as a Miss Lane.
Oh, definitely.
But when he calls her Mac, you know, Barrons... gets into a fight with Malice, a vampire dude, and like knocks him across the room, knocks the shit out of him. He hurry and takes Mac back to the bookstore and speaks over in what sounds like some sort of dead language. And she thinks he kissed her.
Yeah, because she has this concussion. She's not coherent.
She's kind of sort of in and out of consciousness. Yes. Right. But she feels like his whispering words and like his lips are closed. And she's like, it wasn't like any kiss I'd ever felt before. Like,
dun, dun, dun.
So we don't.
No, you don't even know, Mac. You don't even know what's in store. But but you will.
I know. So when she wakes, Barron has kind of comes out of it, right? Yes. Barron has patched her up. She has broken ribs, fingers. It ends. But this is the scene where it ends with Barron's painting her nails for her.
Yes, I love it. They're on the roof. She wants to just be out and about, like in the fresh air.
In the fresh air.
And she needs a manicure and a pedicure, and Barrons is kind of helping her out with that. I love it.
He's painting them pink.
And then I like how she come out of left field while Barrons is like painting her nails. She comes out of left field and she's like, what are you?
Yes, like, so what are you?
Because she's thinking back to that fight. Like, you should have
broken both legs.
You jumped down from the roof. You threw the vampire with superhuman strength. And he was like, no,
he's like, I'm strong. You want to see my muscles?
Yeah.
And he's being very playful in the scene.
And
like,
he's deflecting. And he is deflecting. Yeah.
But I do love that part.
Yeah. And he says, we all have our gifts. You're a null and I am other things.
Yeah.
Thanks. What I'm not is your enemy. He drives us home every single time.
It's like,
every single time,
I took care of you. I saved
every single
you.
Time, Mac is stubborn, does not want to play her cards or show her hand. He always says, like, I'm on your side. I'm on your side.
Right.
But Mac, she wants proof, which I don't blame her.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
As this scene is taking place, Mac is suddenly hit with, like, intense pain, nausea, like everything all at once in her head, and she throws up and passes out like immediately.
Yeah, like
it's
blacks.
Blacks out. And when she comes to come to find out, the dark book had just passed by very close to the bookstore, and that was what caused that reaction.
I love her response. Her response to, like, this is so powerful. This is beyond any of the other objects
like,
of power that have been.
Nobody can even handle this. How could anybody even?
And she asked Barrons, are there other She-Seers out there? She's like, because a war is coming.
Yeah.
So that's how book one ends.
Yeah.
That's how book one ends. So it's very much an introduction into this series, and it's very much priming Mac to be a player in this world.
Right.
And it's just so amazing going back to this book. So I want to give a few warnings out for people who don't want to be spoiled for the entire series, because I feel like it's so amazing to look back and see. I want to explain the hints in here. So if you don't want to be spoiled for the entire series, don't listen to this next point. Yeah. So a few spoilers for the whole series. KMM planned the first 5 books in the series extremely well. The Lord Master, the one who is Alina's boyfriend.
Yes.
You see him in the Highlander books. He is Duroc from the Immortal Highlander. Mm-hmm. He's a villain in that book. That's Adam Black's book.
Yes.
And he is a Sealy, a fallen fae who is stripped of his powers by Avil for planning to use the Hunters, which are She-Seer killers against her.
And that's why he doesn't register on Max.
Right. It's because
radar.
He's no longer a fae.
He doesn't have those. Right.
But he was a fae, and that's why the Unseelie follow him.
Right.
So, yeah. And he's trying to make his way back to heaven, almost like a Lucifer figure, you know?
Yeah.
Like trying to make his way
he's
back.
He's like a fallen angel trying to get back.
The address The house, the 1247 LaRue house, is the Unseelie King's house for his concubine. The black and white floors, the mirrors, yep. They're all there in book one. And we don't even get this until later books.
Until much later.
It's amazing.
I know.
It's amazing.
It's crazy.
I'm like, oh my God, Mac was in this fucking house.
Yeah.
And Mac has so many connections to this house. The mural on the ceiling of BB&B, there is, we find out later, actually, I think it's in the later books, which I don't like particularly care for, like Mac and Barrons are on that mural on the ceiling, but we don't even get that until way later.
Way later. Yeah.
Max, I mentioned before that Max stashes the flashlights around BB&B. This ultimately saves her in the next couple books because Fiona, who is extremely jealous that she's threatened. she's threatened by this young person who Barrons has this interest in. She turns off all the exterior and interior lights. And whenever Mac comes out of her room, it's just darkness.
Right.
Thank God Mac has stashed
the shade,
it. And so she like
the shade gets.
Yeah, she
gets
makes close. Her Michaelo and she has like lights.
Oh, yeah,
all
that's when we
her.
Get the Michaelo. I love that.
Yes. Okay. So this whole Priya thing, this is hints. We got hints, and this is about, this is that line where Mac says that it cost a piece of her soul to be able to resist Flayne, because this is hints that Mac will become Priya, and that's her journey back from Priya. That's what's going to cost her a piece of her soul.
Right.
Flayne shows his true colors in this book because he is Kruse. He's not Flayne at all. He is Kruse.
No.
He has the cuff of Kruse. He offers this to Mac in book one. It is amazing. And he's just masquerading as the light Seelie. And no one's there to contradict him. He just assumed the form of Flayne like hundreds and hundreds of years ago.
Evil.
And he definitely would have raped her in the museum. The way that he actually eventually rapes her in Dream Fever.
Yeah, he eventually does. I mean, she just, she escaped with her own, you know.
Well, but Danny O'Malley is the one that
in this book.
You know, she escapes. She barely escapes. And
That's
actually Flayne, after Flayne Kruse, after, and you can see a personality change in him from this book and the next book. Mm-hmm. In the next book, he changes his strategy to try and seduce her instead of, because obviously her resistance is like more, it's more than he expected from her.
Right, right. He's like, how is she not just...
Yeah, so we get these really mixed signals from Flayne. I actually really liked him before I found out that
before
he
we
was
discovered
Kruse.
That he was, like, worse than the devil, yeah.
Yes, I was like, I really liked Flayne. I was like,
me
I
too.
Don't know.
When
I don't
first
know.
Read
I was
the
like,
series?
I honestly wouldn't mind her being with Flayne while I'm in there. I'm like, oh I love Barrons. No one could beat Barrons. But while I'm reading the series initially, I was
but
like,
that
Flayne's
just,
not
that
so bad.
That just goes to show you how good Moning was in creating this, like, seductive...
Yeah.
Character.
Well, let's go to Barrons. Barrons is mystery man, and he's the one that just propelled me through the series because I'm like, what is Barrons? What is he?
Yeah.
Well, there's hints about voice. He never sleeps. Mac mentions this in this book, how he's such a night owl because he does not need to sleep at all. The shades are afraid of him, and there's a reason why. He is like a he's killed Fae before, like Fae are afraid of him because he is something other. He can jump to rooftops from the street. He tells Mac in this book, some things can't be killed. And yeah, that would be you.
Yep.
Barrons is this, he had this curse placed upon him and he turns into this like monster.
This giant beast. Tiger monster
It's
thing.
Just like this thing.
Yeah.
And oh my God, he's like a killing machine. He literally cannot be killed. Well, he can be killed, but he like regenerates. It's
yeah, he
amazing.
Can be killed. Yeah, him and his buds.
But he can't actually die.
Right.
Not permanently. He also mentions that he has three underground levels beneath his garage where he keeps all of his cars.
Yeah.
And this holds not only the photocopies that we see in book one, but also Barrons' son.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Mac was like,
you
have
like
three levels.
And I like have three levels and he gets all tense
yeah,
when
and he's
she
like,
says
stop.
That.
Going in this direction like I'm not. So Barrons wants the book for his son. This is the whole reason why. This is why he wants a dark book. His son also has the curse, but he can't control it like the rest of the adults can.
Right.
And he wants to be able to like
help him.
Like lay his son down in peace. So that's why he wants it. Okay. Another big one. The old woman, her name is Rowena. She's evil as fuck.
Biatch.
She's fucking evil. God. This whole time in this book, She knows who Mac is. She's playing fucking dumb. She doesn't help Mac because she actually hopes she will die. Yeah. Like the whole time with Lane, she's really not helping her.
Oh yeah, I hope she's like,
I hope you get out because I don't want my plans revealed. She knows she knows who Mac Annalena's mother is. Like she acts like she doesn't know. Like, right. Oh, you must be an O'Connor. She knows exactly who her mother is, Patrona. She's from the Patrona line.
Yeah.
And Rowena is the real reason why Alina is dead. Not a Fae. Right. It's, well, technically a Fae was used, right, but it was Rowena. It was Rowena's plan. She wanted to kill Alina. God, it's like so good.
And it's so complex.
Okay. our vampire dude, Malice. whenever Mac stabs him with the spear, he doesn't die, but he will show up in later books and you'll see him, his flesh is kind of being like eaten away. Mm-hmm. And the reason why he doesn't die, but he's kind of decaying is because he's actually eating. He's like cannibalizing the unseelie to gain that superhuman strength. He's not a vampire.
We're gonna find out that others are doing the same thing,
right? And this is something that Mac herself will use in the future because she doesn't, she wants to be a player, a powerful player. Mm-hmm. She wants to have this extra strength. And so I mean, this is like some really cool shit that happens. Just
there's like so much laid out here that we don't even get until later.
She had these books planned out so intricately. It's honestly mind blowing. So that is why we love Darkfever so much, is because this book is insanely well written.
Yeah,
and I just love KMM. She's an amazing storyteller, and Mac and Barron's journey is one of the most complicated and heart pounding journeys I have ever read.
Yep. Same here.
It just pulls you in. And we're one of the few people who actually loved Iced. I don't think she planned ahead of time to continue the series, but it was so well written, so well received that she wants to continue. She had these characters that she could continue with.
Right, with Danny.
But she kind of fumbled a little bit. We loved Iced. Mm-hmm. Some people were very offended by Iced. And then after that, KMM kind of lost her direction and went back on some of the canon, which I don't like when our people retract canon.
Yeah.
So that's why we don't care for the next couple books.
So we just consider the first five.
The first five. And it has a complete and satisfactory arc.
It does, for Mac and Barrons.
You don't need the rest of the books. But
agreed.
Yeah. So that is our episode on Darkfever.
Yeah. Well, we hoped that you enjoyed today's episode and look forward to the next one where we'll be discussing Beard Science by Penny Reed.
I'm so ready. So ready for this. Me too. One so much. Thanks so much for listening.
This goes out to all the fangirls.
Life's better with a little HEA.